Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Alaska Republic by Stoney Compton, narrated by Curt Bonnem. Prologue. 68 miles south of Delta, Russian America. First Lieutenant Gerald Yamato found himself in the Twin 30 crossfire from three tanks. He felt Satori shudder with each hit, and there were a lot of hits. For a blissful moment, he thought he could stay in the fight. Then his controls went mushy, and the solid stream of smoke from his engine compartment burst into bright flame washing back over his cockpit. Another minute in this situation would kill him. He immediately ejected the canopy, and after jerking his seat restraints free, threw himself into the smoky wake of his doomed P-61, which streamed out of control into the awesome canyon 1,000 feet below the battle. Lieutenant Yamato wrenched his chute around so he could see as much of the battle as possible. While he watched, one of the Eureka fighters suddenly flamed, trailed smoke, and exploded. "Look like Christensen's ship," he said to himself, feeling his heart lurch. Mike was the squadron mascot. A classic, brilliant, self-doomed fuck-off. A tree drifted past, and he realized he had better pay mind to his own predicament. For him, the fight with the Russians was over. An explosion from below pulled his attention to the bottom of the valley. His fighter had impacted at the edge of a river. Someone had claimed it was the Delta River. The wind pushed him farther down the huge canyon. The artist in him took a quick moment to appreciate the majestic beauty of the valley. The miles-long ridge on the far side rippled in shades of reds, pinks, greens, and even light purples, like a technicolor layer cake cut and toppled on its side. Then the pragmatic flyer took over, and he worked his chute in order to come down near the river, rather than hang up in the middle of the forest bordering both sides of the obviously swift-moving water. Even before the ground rushed up and grabbed him, he wondered what equipment he had, and would it be enough? His landing was textbook. Take the shock with his feet together, and collapse in a rolling tumble. Unlike the field back in Napa Valley, this one was covered with boulders and rocks the size of his head. He landed on a small boulder, and his feet slid off to the right. He threw his arm out and instantly jerked it to his side again. He couldn't risk breaking it. His shoulder took the majority of the impact and immediately went numb. Jerry threw out his hands and stopped himself. The parachute settled on the rocky floodplain, began to fill from the constant breeze moving alongside the water. He pushed himself up and jerked the shroud lines, collapsing the silk. His shoulder hurt like hell, but he swiftly pulled the lines into a pile at his feet. Just as his hands touched the silk canopy, he heard a massive explosion from above. He looked up the incredible slope. At first, he saw nothing but smoke pouring down from the road on the canyon rim. Then he saw awful movement. At least 9 Russian tanks avalanched down the steep wall, rotating in deadly descent, thunderously smashing flat the rocks and trees before crashing into each other or bouncing farther out into the canyon. Huge boulders and entire swaths of trees boiled in a descending, dust-shrouded dance of death. Behind the maelstrom tumbled a boulder larger than any tank, gouging out 60-meter-wide swaths of mountainside before spinning out into the air again, following the doomed Russian war machines into the abyss. A multitude of conflicting thoughts ran through his head as he waited for his companions to finish their preparations for the impending trek. First Lieutenant Jerry Yamato realized he had run out of options. As an officer of the Republic of California Air Force, his first duty was to complete his mission. Well, getting shot down in combat certainly ended my mission. He would never forget the vivid memory of enemy fire hitting Satori, and the sudden lack of control as the P-61 Eureka transformed from sleek fighter plane into burning debris falling out of the sky. Rolling the bird over so he could open the canopy, jerk his seat harness free, and drop out of the cockpit through the flames roaring back from the engine had taken less time to do than it would to describe the actions. The ache in his shoulder attested to his poor landing. Of course there had to be boulders all over the ground. His other choice had been to land in the fast-flowing river that threaded through the boulder field. Parachuting into moving water became a recipe for disaster. He accepted the aching shoulder as a reminder of choosing the lesser of two evils. His second duty was to return to his command as soon as possible. Well, that was finally about to commence. However, he hadn't counted on being attacked by a survivor of the Russian armored column that his squadron had all but destroyed. How a man could fall into a valley along with tanks and armored personnel carriers and still live loomed nearly beyond belief. Sergeant Sermanovich had not only survived the fall, he had also tried to kill Jerry with a rifle. Jerry's aim with his Service 45 kept the sergeant alive. Jerry had aimed at the man's head and hit the rifle in his hands instead. The blow had knocked the Russian sergeant off the rock on which he sat and, in his condition, took him out of the fight. Or took the fight out of him, Jerry mused. Then things got really complicated. Jerry had an unconscious prisoner who didn't look as if he could live another hour, and he stood in the middle of an unknown vast wilderness that happened to be in enemy territory. The 117th Fighter Squadron had flown many miles over Russian America, and the only sign of human habitation or toil had been the road over the mountain pass where they attacked the Russian armor. To be honest, he had considered putting the damaged Russian out of his misery. For all Jerry knew, this son of a bitch might have shot him down. Killing a man in combat could be considered duty. Putting a bullet through the brain of an unconscious man from 3 feet away seemed like murder. So he woke the soldier and met Sergeant Rudy Sermanovich, who had been the gunner on the lead tank, which meant he was the son of a bitch who shot Jerry down. And when he tried to stand, he passed out again. With a simple litter, Jerry dragged the mercifully unconscious sergeant back to where he had left his parachute and other gear. After a very long, exhausting time, he thought he should be in the right area, but his gear had vanished. Suddenly, a beautiful woman appeared, who had enough words of English to ask if he spoke Russian. And then he saw stars when a rock hit the back of his head. Once he regained consciousness, tied securely with his own parachute lines, he met Pelagian, a 6-foot-tall muscular man who had the blood of numerous races flowing through his veins. Piercing blue eyes and skin the shade of coffee with cream made for a very arresting figure. His wife, Boadicea, stood all of 5 feet, and with her chiseled beauty looked mostly of Alaskan native ancestry. The beautiful woman who had rendered him witless in more ways than one was Magda, their daughter. After Jerry and Rudy both explained their presence, Pelagian had freed them and offered them assistance. A great weight lifted off Jerry's shoulders at that moment. He and the sergeant just might live through this after all. When he explained that he had been shot down while fighting in aid of a Dene revolution against the Tsar, the effect on his rescuers had been electric. It seemed they were all on the same side, except Rudy, of course. Pelagian and his family had been in the bush for months and knew nothing of the battles fought between Russia and the Dene separatist movement and their allies. Jerry wondered if these people could really get him and Sergeant Rudy Sermanovich out of the wilderness alive. He glanced at Magda, who happened to look at him at the same time. Interest shone in her eyes, and that buoyed him immensely. Well, I joined the Air Force for adventure. Mother always told me to be careful of what I wished for. 1. Pelagian felt relief that he didn't have to kill the Californian. However, he maintained a close, unobtrusive watch on Lieutenant Gerald Yamato. So far, the young pilot from the Republic of California impressed him. He could have killed the Russian tanker sergeant, and it would have been the fortunes of war. The sergeant would not have hesitated. In fact, he had tried twice his best to kill the pilot and not succeeded. If he had, there would have been two bodies to bury out there in Rainbow Valley. Instead, they were all busy rigging a litter to haul Sergeant Rudy Sermanovich to Delta, where he could get decent care without being jostled all over the length and breadth of Russian America. 60-odd miles were nothing for a healthy person, a few days' walk. But carrying a litter through what had suddenly become enemy territory might evolve into a much larger challenge. Lieutenant Yamato had told them about the Dene Revolution against the Tsar, about the Battle of China, and the death of Slayer of Men, Pelagian's good friend and cousin to Boadicea. His wife had not shown much emotion, but he knew what to look for on the face of the woman he loved. She had taken the news of the death hard, rock hard, and he pitied any Russian soldier who fell into her gun sights. Along with their daughter Magda, they had watched the sleek warplanes attack an unseen Russian armored column far above them on Baranov Pass near Rainbow Ridge. At the beginning, there had been 15 aircraft diving and firing. Only 7 flew away to the north after the shooting stopped. They had witnessed the destruction of 3 of the planes, including Lieutenant Yamato's. The 4th had been destroyed out of their line of sight. Having been a military pilot, in another time and another place, Pelagian knew how close the lieutenant must have been to the men who died back there. He would carefully choose the time to discuss the battle with Lieutenant Yamato. Magda moved around Jerry like a cat, curious but very wary. Pelagian didn't dwell on that aspect of the situation, since it didn't involve him. He knew his daughter could handle herself, physically and emotionally. Boadicea finished testing the knots on the litter and gave him a long look and a sharp nod.
"Let's go to Delta," he said,
and slipped into the harness, bearing the weight of the front of the litter. Jerry Yamato stumbled again. How far had they walked? How long had they been walking? The litter bearing the wounded Russian tanker sergeant had to weigh 200 pounds at the very least. Pelagian wore the parachute harness bearing the front weight of the litter as if it were a light cloak. The rope sling in the back cut into Jerry's shoulders, and he gripped the end of the litter, constantly lifting it with raw, blistering hands to ease the burden on his aching shoulders. He could barely move, but he gamely continued. Following the man wasn't difficult. Pelagian inspired confidence. The dogs, bearing a goodly share of the load tied to a pole between them, which supported the right and left sides of the litter, seemed as fresh as when they started the journey. Boadicea, Pelagian's small, sharply handsome shamanistic wife, and Magda, their stunningly beautiful daughter, both carried heavy packs with the air of being on an amble in the park. Jerry refused to whine about his condition. He stumbled again. Pelagian said,
"This is a good place,"
and everybody stopped moving. The women dropped their packs and immediately unslung the dogs from the litter. The dogs wandered around and thoroughly marked the area. Pelagian nodded to Jerry, and they lowered the litter to the ground. For the first time, Jerry noticed the clear creek running parallel to their route, and the high grassy meadow surrounded by mountains in which they found themselves. Back and legs aching, he lowered himself to the ground and lay down.
"Lieutenant, wake up. You must eat."
Magda's voice ended Jerry's dream, and his eyes popped open. She knelt next to him, holding out a wooden bowl full of steaming, savory-smelling food. He scrambled to a sitting position and took the bowl. "How long was I asleep?" From the warmth in his face, he knew he was blushing.
"A few hours. Not to worry, you are exhausted. After we eat, everyone will sleep."
Pelagian and Boadicea already sat cross-legged on the ground, eating. Nodding dumbly, he shoveled what proved to be stew into his mouth. Large chunks of meat enhanced by carrots, potatoes, and unknown herbs made for a completely satisfying meal. The worn spoon boasted the twin-headed eagle of Imperial Russia on its handle. "Nice silverware," he said, glancing at Boadicea and grinning. "The Tsar give it to you for a wedding present?"
"No, I traded beadwork for it," Boadicea said.
Jerry wondered if the woman ever smiled. He noticed Rudy still slept, but the bloody, fouled uniform had vanished, and clean blankets covered him. Jerry hadn't thought about what Rudy's personal condition might be. "I'm trained in wilderness survival, yet I feel so stupid here," he thought.
"Is there a wife waiting for you in Castroville?"
Magda asked.
"No. I had a girlfriend, but she
found somebody else just before the war started. In a way, I'm glad I'm not tied down right now. You never know what's going to happen in a combat situation."
"Then the relationship was not serious to begin with?"
"I wanted it to be for a long time, but no, I don't think it ever was." Magda frowned.
"So why did you not seek a serious relationship?"
Jerry set his empty bowl beside him, contentedly patted his belly, and stared into her lustrous eyes.
"I'm still working on it."
She smiled and blinked.
"I'm sure you are."
From behind her, she produced two blankets.
"Here is your bedding. I'll see you in a few hours."
She stood and walked away. He watched her body move under the soft moose hide, and wondered if there was a sweetheart waiting for her back in Delta, or wherever they called home. Straightening one blanket on the ground, he wrapped the other around him and fell asleep as soon as he lay down. His plane flew straight toward the flashing muzzles on the row of tanks, but his guns wouldn't fire, nor could he make the aircraft turn away from what was sure to be instant death in mere moments. Bullets hit his plane. Chunks of metal ripped away, the canopy fragmented in silent explosion. He pounded on the stick to make the bird turn, but it wouldn't. Something hit his foot, and he jerked out of the nightmare, still shuddering.
"Wake up, Lieutenant,"
Pelagian said from somewhere in the clouds.
"We're leaving soon."
Jerry let the dream ebb as he lay in his wadded blankets. The ubiquitous daylight felt cool to his sweating face. The aroma of cooking food brought him completely awake. After rolling his blankets together, he set them near Rudy's litter. The sergeant smiled at him.
"Fighting dream battle, yes?"
"Yes. How did you know?"
"Have been in army long time. It happens to most."
"How long until the dreams stop?"
"I'll tell you when mine do."
Jerry thought about that for a moment, and then shook his head.
"So, how do you feel, Sergeant Simonovich? You look better than the last time I saw you."
"For first time since Colonel Lazarev's tank was blown off ridge, I don't hurt. People rarely appreciate lack of pain, but from now forward, I do."
Boadicea walked over and handed them both bowls of food.
"If you wish to heal, Sergeant, you will stay in that litter for 2 more days. Then you may walk on your own if you are capable."
Jerry looked down at his bowl. Potatoes and 6 small eggs fried sunny side up.
"I feel good to walk now."
"If you walk today, you will be dead by the end of tomorrow. You have many injuries, which need at least that long to begin healing. 2 more days in the litter, and you may live to see grandchildren."
"Where did you get fresh eggs?" Jerry asked. Boadicea nearly smiled.
"Birds lay them everywhere. You just need to know where to find them."
"I'm glad you knew. Thank you." Boadicea actually smiled and nodded her head before turning back to her family sitting around the campfire.
"Please help me sit up," Simonovich said.
Jerry grabbed the man's wrist and hauled him into a sitting position. It took much less effort than he thought it would. Rudy gasped, sat still for a long moment, then began eating and looking around at the same time.
"We are not in last remembered location. River is different, and the ridge is gone. Who carried me here?"
Between bites, Jerry told him about the dogs and the litter lash-up.
"You helped carry me?"
"I told you. Our war is over until we can return to our own people. Don't you agree?"
Sermanovich looked up from his food.
"I agreed in concept. I never believe you mean it."
"Oh, hell, Rudy, I don't mean it. I'm going to shoot you the first chance I get."
"Do not believe that either," Rudy said with a laugh. "You are very different from other armies I have fought. I do not think you are a good soldier, but you are a good man, for which I remain grateful."
"Thanks, I think," Jerry said, running back over it in his mind, trying to decide if he should feel insulted. Pelagian loomed over them before sitting next to the litter.
"We will sleep in Delta the day after tomorrow, if you can both handle the pace. I realize that neither of you are Yukon Cassidy."
Rudy lay back and grinned.
"It's no problem for me."
"Lieutenant?"
The blue eyes gleamed at Jerry. "I've had a good night's sleep and a full meal. You bet I can handle it."
"Good. Today you wear the harness in front."
"But I don't know where I'm going."
"Just follow Magda."
Pelagian gave him a wolfish grin.
"You can do that, can't you?"
"Definitely," Jerry said, holding the man's gaze. "Who's Yukon Cassidy?"
"A warrior of legend, and he holds his own. I am honored to have him as a friend."
"Will I meet him?"
"If you are fortunate."
A half hour later, they stretched out down the trail headed north. Jerry found his stride, and in addition to watching Magda in front of him, appreciated the landscape around them. They climbed a ridge and dropped down into a wide valley. In the distance, Jerry noticed a mountain he had seen from his plane. At this elevation, it loomed even more majestically. He called ahead to Magda.
"What do you call that?"
She glanced back to see where he pointed, followed the direction with her eyes, and came to a complete stop.
"That is Denali, a holy place for our people, and the heart of the Dene Nation."
"Oh, it sort of reminds me of Mount Shasta back in the Republic." She turned to him, eyes shining.
"You also have a holy mountain?"
"Not everybody regards it that way, but yes." Bodisha walked back down the trail to them, her eyebrows arched.
"May we continue now?"
Pelagian chuckled and said in a low voice,
"I wouldn't waste any more time if I were you."
Jerry grinned back over his shoulder.
"I thought you were in charge here."
"A woman is not property, and husbands who think otherwise are living in a dream world. My friend Bob told me that, and he was right."
"He sounds like a wise man,"
Rudy commented.
"Is permissible to sing?"
"No,"
Jerry and Pelagian said simultaneously.
"You two worry me."
The lower elevations of the valley brought more water, standing and active. They forded two cold, fast-moving creeks. Jerry noticed early that they followed a trail, a mere suggestion in some places, and well-defined in others. Now the trail bore more unmistakable wheel tracks, as well as those of human and animal.
"How much farther to Delta?" Jerry asked Magda.
She dropped back and, in a low voice, said,
"Just beyond the mountain you see in the distance there."
She pointed. They were going through a vast stretch of willows, more bushes than trees. The tallest stood no more than 2 meters.
"Why are you whispering?"
"Because we are very near a redoubt,
and we do not wish to explain your presence to the Russians.
Listen to her, Rudy said in a low voice. They would kill us all.
Even you? Jerry whispered.
I am among enemies and still breathe. Therefore, traitor to the Tsar. The Imperial Russian army is bereft of nuance or sentiment.
Do you want to go in alone?
How to explain presence in this condition? I am too many versts from my command. Perhaps deserter? No, I stay with you.
A bird call drifted back and Pelagian snapped.
Quiet! Get off the trail!
Magda spoke to the dogs and they followed her into the brush. She led them down into a small depression and spoke again. All four dogs quietly lay down, tongues lolling. Pelagian slipped out of his sling and pulled a hatchet from the pack Magda had carried.
You all wait here quietly, he said.
He disappeared toward the trail. Jerry unbuckled the harness and gratefully let it slide to the ground. Not since flight school, when he was a cadet, had he expended this much effort on a continuous basis. He eased to the ground next to Rudy's litter and fell into a light doze. Something pressed firmly over his mouth, and his eyes popped open to see Magda holding her other hand up, index finger over her mouth. He nodded his head, and she took her hand off him. She handed him his automatic. He dropped the clip enough to see it was still full. As he quietly pressed the clip back into the pistol butt, he looked around, finally catching Magda's eye again. He elaborately shrugged. She knelt down beside him and pointed toward the wall of brush between them and the trail. Suddenly, he heard the voices. Unknown voices speaking Russian. Jerry slowly pulled the barrel back on the automatic until he could see the round in the chamber. He glanced around. Rudy lay belly down on his litter, holding a huge revolver in both hands and aiming toward the voices. Both Pelagian and Boadicea were nowhere to be seen. Jerry's heartbeat increased and his mouth felt dry. The summer sun beat down from a cloudless sky, and mosquitoes circled around them. Sweat stung his eyes, but he didn't move. The voices were no more than 50 meters away. He could hear boots scuffing the small rocks and dirt on the trail despite the breeze high in the willows. The constant wind wasn't strong enough to get down to where he crouched. Time hadn't slowed this much for him since he had to watch an ice cube melt when he was a child. Back then, he had been restricted to a chair until the ice turned to a puddle. Now, he had no idea what was required of him, other than staying alive. The voices receded slightly, and Jerry's heartbeat slowed. He smiled over at Magda just as she unsuccessfully tried to muffle her sneeze. One of the unseen voices said something short and sharp. Silence grew, and Jerry's heartbeat increased. The barrel of his .45 trembled, and he wished he could stop sweating.
Yah!
Three Russian soldiers burst through the brush, nearly overrunning them. Two held rifles at high port, the third led with his machine pistol pointed forward. Jerry, Magda, and Rudy all shot the man with the machine pistol, who fell flat in front of them, instantly dead. The other two soldiers jerked their weapons down toward the three. Multiple shots rang out, and both men lost all coordination and collapsed, dead before they hit the ground. Silence reigned as dust motes drifted and settled. A hoarse shout in Russian from beyond the brush.
Shout out, comrades!
More silence. Abruptly, a heavy weapon opened up, spraying the area with large caliber rounds. Three rounds hit the dead Russian directly in front of Jerry, causing the corpse to jerk as if it felt the damage. Somewhere out in the brush, Pelagian said,
Damn, they hit me!
Father!
Magda yelled and started to her feet. Jerry grabbed her arm and jerked her back down. She turned on him with bared teeth.
What do you...
thick fire stitched through the brush over their heads, blowing the small trees in half with single rounds. The sharp scent of sap and cut wood joined the light haze of cordite in the air.
"We have to put an end to that one,"
Rudy said with a growl.
"You go left, I'll go right."
Before Jerry could say anything, Rudy grabbed the machine pistol out of the dead corporal's hands and wriggled into the brush, grunting with effort. Jerry grabbed one of the fallen rifles and quickly made sure it was loaded.
"Stay here and shoot anyone who comes crawling through the brush. We'll be on our feet."
Magda stared at him with wide eyes.
"Duh."
Jerry crawled through the dust and weeds, slowed when he came to an opening in the brush before him. This was another reason he hadn't joined the infantry. He hated being dirty. He stopped in front of the opening, listening intently. Panting, he heard pain being unsuccessfully suppressed.
"It's Yamato,"
he whispered, and pushed through the opening. At the side of a wounded Pelagian, Bodisha held a machine pistol, pointing at Jerry. As soon as she saw his face, she aimed at the brush in front of them.
"He's hit in the side,"
she said in a low, emotionless tone.
"I need the automatic weapon."
They silently traded weapons.
"Thanks. I'll be right back."
Jerry crawled as quietly as he could away from the couple before turning toward where he knew the enemy lurked. The heavy willows moved in the breeze and were easy for him to negotiate, but he knew the top portion of the branches signaled his advance. He backed up and moved down into a small swale before stopping to rest. The hammer of the heavy weapon followed the bullets chopping down willows wholesale right where he had turned back. He shrieked,
"Ah!"
and hoped for the best. The fire ceased, and he immediately squirmed down the leveled path, appreciating how much the downed willows suppressed the dust. If the Russian gunner believed his cry, Rudy might believe it too, and do something foolish. But what if the Russian didn't believe his cry? What if he was waiting for a stupid first lieutenant to stumble through the trees so he could cut him in half? His heart hammered, and Jerry found it difficult to swallow. Heat suffused the entire universe, and he tried not to think about water. Suddenly, he ran out of the downed willows and stopped. With his mouth hanging open, he desperately listened for any sound beyond the bluish-green leaves screening him from the threat beyond. The rattle of a machine gun belt carried through the dusty air. Jerry decided the gunner was reloading. He sat back on his haunches and rose to his feet, hunched over and terrified. He decided it was now or never. He charged through the willows and into the open. 2. 90 miles east of St. Anthony Redoubt. For at least the 1,000th time, Lieutenant Colonel Sam DeJanecki wished the Imperial Russian Army would line tank hatches with rubber or something softer than steel. His kidneys were taking a beating as the Imperial 5th Armored rumbled toward Chena Redoubt from Tetlin Redoubt. The Russian America Company could certainly profit by making the Russia-Canada highway more travel-friendly. The smallest stone in the semi-packed surface looked larger than his fist. But then, his column of 30 tanks, 15 trucks, and assorted other vehicles were tearing along at 15 kilometers per hour, which made it impossible for his driver to avoid the larger rocks. As his Zhukov jarred over yet another small boulder, his radio man broke in on his comm channel.
"Colonel, communication from St. Nicholas Redoubt."
"Pechetin, Kerensky."
A click transferred him to a different frequency.
"This is Lieutenant Colonel Janecki of the 5th Armored."
"Janecki,"
the voice came through scratchy.
"This is Skolovich."
"Georgi, my friend, how are you?"
They had been friends for over 20 years, and Georgi, a full colonel, now sat behind an impressive desk in St. Nicholas Redoubt as deputy commander of Northern Land Forces in Russian America. Georgi would get a star before Janecki did.
My health is good, thank you, Samdi, but I must make you aware of bad news.
Am I being replaced? Colonel Skolovich forced a laugh.
No, nothing like that. In fact, at the moment, you are irreplaceable. Lazarev and the Flash Division have been destroyed crossing the Alaska Range.
Destroyed? By whom?
The Republic of California Air Force.
Janecki could hear the disgust in his friend's voice.
They've also cut the road. Now everything must go through Titlin first.
Don't worry, Georgie. The 5th Armored can handle the mission.
I am not finished with bad news, Samdi. Tetlin Redoubt is under armored attack from the east.
California again?
No, the First People's Nation. They have taken the British Army out of the war and are hitting Tetlin with at least 36 tanks. You took all our armor with you, didn't you?
As ordered,
Janecki said, angry that his voice had tightened along with his jaw.
I know those were your orders. I issued them. This FPN thing caught us flat-footed. We do have artillery and infantry there, and they are offering a stiff resistance.
Janecki instantly felt mollified.
Do you want me to stop my advance and return to Tetlin, Colonel?
No. You should be linking up with your old mentor Milosevic within 24 hours. He has lost his ass at China and will be full of doom and gloom. Turn him around and hit China again. We need to be as deep into Dena territory as possible when the ceasefire order comes down.
Ceasefire order? Why would they do that? We're just getting started in this wasteland. Only a small fraction of the army has been committed to stop this piddling revolt.
It's not common knowledge yet. Imperial Command is trying to pull its fat out of the fire, but most of the Pacific Fleet went to the bottom day before yesterday, courtesy of the Republic of California Navy.
Oh, Jesus. Janecki breathed into the microphone.
It gets worse, Sunday. No sooner than the diplomats asked for peace terms, the Japanese Navy started shelling Naval Base Kodiak.
The Japanese?
Janecki shouted.
Where the hell did they come from?
It seems the Kalash are pulling the same crap on us that Dena did. Only they asked the Japanese for military aid rather than the USA or the ROC.
Who isn't up here messing in our internal affairs?
As near as we can figure, the CSA, Republic of Texas, and Deseret.
Well, that's a damned relief. No religious zealots to worry about.
I don't think the Mormons have an army as such.
Mormons? I was speaking of the Confederacy, wild-eyed Protestants to the last man.
Colonel Skolovich's laugh was genuine this time.
I'm glad you still have your sense of humor, my friend, because you're going to need it.
Any idea when this ceasefire order will come down from on high?
No. We know the Baltic fleet has steamed east to help, but we don't know if they will be in time to make a difference. In my opinion, High Command has put Alaska further down the list of important things to think about. I think they're worried about Mother Russia's east coast with the Japanese threat.
So we are fighting a lost cause, Georgie?
Perhaps, Sandy, perhaps.
Not if I can help it, old friend.
3. Tanana Hospital, Dena Republic.
What is the status of our army, General Aluska?
General Grisha Grigorievich, commanding general of the fledgling Dena Republic Army, asked impatiently from his hospital bed. Paul Aluska flashed a shy grin and then settled back into his new role.
Sorry about your leg, Grisha. I sent them California troopers under Colonel Berman and Major Smulz with a platoon of our guys after the retreating Russians. Between them, they got about 200 men. Then Colonel Jackson showed up with his California Rangers, another 200 men, and I told him to go find Colonel Berman's group and help out.
Are the Russians still fighting, or just getting the hell out of Huslia?
They ain't nowhere near Huslia, Grisha, Paul said with a frown. They're headed for Delta.
I'm just trying to be funny or something. Can't do much else with this leg I'll trust up. What's in Delta?
That's where St. Anthony Redoubt is, with a small Russian garrison that's never seen combat yet, all fresh and ready to go.
Any idea how many?
Last I heard from Doyen Williams, right about 100.
What kind of armor?
I think they got 3 tanks, a couple small cannons, and a helicopter. They just guard the Rusty Can Highway, Grisha, and provide a place to stay for traveling Russian big shots.
Colonel Wing Grigorievich cleared her throat and put her hand on her husband's arm.
General Aluska, have we any information on Russian movements south of Delta?
All we know is what Grisha's flight spotted on the way to China. The FPN army is headed north, and there was a column of tanks and other vehicles ahead of them. I think it's safe to say they're Russian.
That was 2 days ago. I thought the Russians had asked for terms, Grisha snapped, frowning at his broken leg.
St. Petersburg did ask for terms.
Wing cleared her throat again and continued.
But their army has yet to wave any white flags or show signs of stopping. They're probably trying to gain as much territory as they can.
A knock sounded on the closed door.
General Grigorievich?
Sergeant Major Nelson Tobias's voice came through the door at a respectful level in cadence with the rap of his knuckles.
Please come in, Sergeant Major, Grisha said.
Tobias pushed open the hospital door and stepped inside, barely, before straightening to attention.
We have priority messages from the USA and the ROC commands.
What do they say?
Colonel Wing Grigorievich asked. She put her hand on her husband's bed, and the general covered it with his.
The ROC has sent her fleet north into the Gulf of Alaska, which includes air support. And the USA? Grisha asked. Claims one of their submarines sank a Russian destroyer in Clarence Strait in the Russian portion of the Inside Passage.
The fifth person in the room broke his silence.
It seems our people are going to get the aid they requested.
Grisha smiled at his cousin, Captain Peter Chernikov of the Tlingit Nation Army.
Whatever happens, Peter, our old world is gone forever. Do you really think it can get worse than it was, Grisha? I don't know. Ask me a year from now.
There was one more thing, General, Sergeant Major Tobias said, his mouth working as if he smelled something unpleasant.
Yes? The Imperial Japanese fleet shelled and effectively destroyed the Imperial Russian naval base at Kodiak at 0200. Imperial Russia has declared war on the Imperial Japanese Empire. My God, Grisha blurted.
That's insane, Wing said.
That was not supposed to happen. Peter's tone carried anger. What do you mean by that? Grisha snapped. We asked them to posture, nothing more.
Peter's face had gone as pale as possible.
They would demonstrate and then leave. We were sure we could get the Russians to back down. You made a treaty with the Japanese?
Grisha felt stunned and terrified at the same time.
At the time, we felt we had no other choice.
Peter's voice trailed away.
Now that's what's insane, Wing said. Did you leave any soft spots in your treaty's perimeter? Someplace they could break through with impunity if it served their purpose?
Peter's face flushed, and he opened his mouth to respond, eyes dark and brow constricted. But he held his tongue long enough to digest her words. His mouth snapped shut, and the frown lost contour and dissipated.
Perhaps,
he said, and his face reddened further.
I would need to revisit what I urged to be signed.
Can you rescind the treaty? Grisha asked.
Unlikely, cousin.
So, we potentially have a new war to consider.
Grisha, Wing blurted. We have no navy. We barely have an army. The Japanese have both in numbers we can't defeat.
She's got a couple of good points there, Grisha, Paul Leluska said.
But we have allies, no?
Grisha searched all their faces, but found no answer.
Japan has a huge navy, Wing said in a gentle voice.
I must get in contact with my brother, Paul, Peter said. As soon as possible.
I'll introduce you to our communications people, Wing said. Follow me.
4. 40 miles northwest of Delta. Major Joe Coffey of Easy Company, 3rd Parachute Infantry Regiment, Republic of California Army, hustled through the woods and dropped next to his commanding officer.
They aren't doing much rear guard-wise, Del. Colonel Berman.
You're out of shape, Joe,
the colonel said with a wide grin, only partially covered by his walrus mustache.
How far ahead are they?
No more than half a click.
Shit, I couldn't run farther than that. Do they know we're back here?
Don't think so. They seem more worried about what's in front of them. They don't act like an army in full retreat.
Good. But if they figure out we're back here, it could get hairy and damn fast. Nothing like a cornered rat for a real fight.
Kind of reminds me of that Spanish fight over in the Arizona no man's land. Remember that?
How the hell could I forget it? Colonel Berman said with a snort. Only time I've ever been suckered. And by the she-pumping Spanish at that.
But we kicked their asses, Major Coffey said through his grin.
And we lost 4 good men because we weren't paying attention.
Coffey's smile evaporated. Yeah, that's right. Better keep our act together on this one, huh?
Couldn't have put it better myself. Where did they have their tanks?
Way forward. You'd think they were attacking instead of retreating.
I've come to the conclusion that General Mislavich likes to kid himself. He never retreats, only attacks. That suggests he's vain and can be bullshitted. Good thing to know about your enemy.
Sometimes you scare me, Colonel Berman.
I must be losing my edge. Used to be you were in constant terror of me.
He grinned again. Joe laughed. He and Dell had gone through the Presidio together. The officers the Republic of California Military Academy provided could more than match anything offered by West Point, VMI, TMI, or Sandhurst. It had taken Joe Coffey 9 long years to make major. Marginal peacetime was hell for a soldier. But Dell had made colonel in the same amount of time. Joe felt no envy. Dell was the smartest man he had ever met. Give him another 5 years and he'd have stars on his shoulders, no doubt about it.
Constant terror? Nah.
Worried that we might not live through your latest adventure, maybe. You always pull us through, and I'll take that to the bank.
As if you ever had anything left over to put in a bank.
Colonel Berman was still grinning. 5. 63 miles south of Delta. Rudy could make out the hulking armored personnel carrier through the light screen of willows. He aimed toward the machine and waited for movement. Moments before, he had heard the death cry of the Oriental California pilot. Despite his self-avowal not to dwell on it until later, Jerry's face flashed through his mind. He was beginning to like that boy, even if he was a goddamn first lieutenant. Now, this pustule-infested, borscht-eating, lice-picking, mouth-breathing, self-abusing son of a bitch in front of him had ended Jerry's life. Rudy tried to maintain his sergeant's distance. Something clinked, and he focused. Another clink.
The whoreson is reloading his heavy machine gun.
He painfully pulled himself to his feet and stepped as quickly as he could through the willows. The corporal behind the twin 9mm machine guns jerked his head up in surprise and quickly brought the muzzle around to bear on Rudy. A burst of automatic fire blossomed a row of blood roses across the corporal's chest and toppled him lifelessly over the edge of the gun tub onto the mud-scarred trail. Jerry Yamato let his weapon drop to his side and grinned at Rudy.
I knew you were going to try something crazy, but your timing was perfect.
Rudy felt something other than pain inside him. He grinned and pointed to the armored personnel carrier.
It's good to ensure there are no others.
Jerry walked around the machine, poked his weapon inside the troop compartment, and let loose a string of shots. Silence fell over the area.
So how far is it to the closest redoubt?
I would know this how?
Rudy asked, gesturing with his unburdened hand.
I am as new to Russian America as the lieutenant, and like you, I no longer have my MIPS.
Good point.
His face went bleak.
Jesus, I nearly forgot. Pelagian has been hit.
As quickly as possible, Rudy followed Yamato into the brush. The amount of pain he constantly suppressed had lessened over the past day, for which he was grateful. To tell the full truth, he felt fortunate to be alive. The forever fall down the mountain did things to him that other men would not have survived. Being obstinate helped, he felt sure, but Bodisha had worked magic on him and saved his life. She had also put clean clothing on him and replaced his boots. He owed these people. It had been a very long time since he felt that way about anyone. It occurred to him that he felt more loyalty to them than to anyone or anything else. Pelagian lay on the ground, using part of the parachute for a pillow. Bodisha knelt beside him, her back to the others, working on the wound. Pelagian appeared gray and wrung out. Rudy wondered where all those worry lines on the man's face had suddenly come from.
Magda, come on in,
Jerry called. He surveyed the couple on the ground.
How is he?
I've stopped the bleeding. Now I must remove the bullet.
It didn't go through him? That's amazing.
We think it hit a branch first. We were both out of the line of fire, and we believe the bullet was a ricochet. It could have been worse, but this is bad enough.
Magda crept up as if her sudden presence would frighten.
Father is wounded. Yes, but I am going to take out the bullet. All of you can help me.
How will you remove the bullet?
Rudy asked.
I have ways. Sergeant, you move over here, she pointed. And, Lieutenant, you go right there.
Immediately, both men knelt on either side of the fallen giant.
Hold him. This will probably hurt.
What can I do?
Magda asked in a girlish voice.
Get hold of yourself and then give me every bit of your strength you can.
Beloved,
Pelagian said in a papery tone.
For you, I would endure anything.
Good.
Bodisha said with starch in her voice.
Now don't move.
Rudy followed Jerry's lead and rested his hand on the wounded man's arm. Bodisha cupped her hands over the blood-oozing wound and closed her eyes. The muscles in her neck and jaw stood out, slightly quivering. Magda stood directly behind her mother, as close as she could without touching. She tensed her body and lifted her face to the sun. Pelagian went rigid. Sweat popped out on his face and chest. His eyes rolled far back, and Rudy thought the man would faint.
It's coming, Bodisha said in a gasp.
Rudy thought he saw white light between her palms, but realized that was impossible. Pelagian arched his back, straining against their hands as Bodisha held her still-cupped hands over him. A gout of blood erupted from the man's side with a small poit sound, and Boadicea grinned as Pelagian fell back in a swoon.
"I got it," she said.
"Got what?" Jerry asked. Rudy knew, but he wanted proof just the same. Boadicea opened her hand, and a bloody lump of disfigured lead rested on her palm.
"This was the easy part. Now I must make him heal."
"That fast?" Jerry asked. Boadicea and Rudy laughed in unison.
"No," Boadicea said. "It will take time."
"After seeing that," Jerry said, "I believe you could do almost anything."
"I can't hurry time, which is a good thing, because that's all we have."
Magda slumped to her knees and rested her head on her mother's back.
"What can we do?"
Rudy asked. He felt a deep, nearly religious awe and affection for this healer.
"See if you can get that machine started. We need to get to Delta as soon as possible."
"As you wish, Boadicea."
Rudy looked up at the lieutenant.
"Do you know engines?"
"I know they run on gas and oil." "Don't look at me like that. I'm a pilot. I have a ground crew to keep my plane operational."
"Come with me anyway."
As in most Imperial Russian Army vehicles, a key was not needed. Ignition began with the push of a button. But on this vehicle, pushing the button produced a flat click.
"Damn."
Rudy opened the engine compartment and began tugging on wires and prodding at components.
"Look inside for tools."
"Yes, Sergeant." Rudy grinned.
"No disrespect intended, Lieutenant."
Yamato dropped a toolbox on the fender next to Rudy. "Is the battery damaged?"
"Excellent question."
He followed the wiring back to a compartment under the floorboards. The battery leaked acid from 3 bullet holes.
"No, it's not damaged. It's destroyed."
"Oh shit, really?" Yamato stuck his head in the compartment and retreated immediately. "I thought I didn't hit anything."
"Would seem you are better shot than appreciated."
"How are we going to get them out of here, Rudy?" He gave the younger man a bleak look.
"How do I get me out of here?"
Yamato went silent. Rudy didn't like that. He suspected the man produced crazy ideas when he didn't talk.
"Let's go give them the bad news," Yamato said.
"Bah."
Boadicea looked up when they returned to the small clearing.
"Battery was destroyed in the fighting," Rudy said.
She looked blank.
"The battery supplies the electrical power to start the vehicle and stores additional power from the generator once the vehicle is running," Yamato said.
Rudy looked at him.
"Thought you knew nothing about it."
"My dad is a mechanical engineer. Something must have rubbed off."
For an instant, Rudy remembered his father, drunk and beating Rudy's mother, right before Rudy knocked him flat with a pick handle. That was the day he had joined the army. He had only 15 years at the time.
"Rudy, you okay?"
"Yes, of course."
He looked at Boadicea again.
"The lieutenant describes situation succinctly. Under present circumstances, vehicle is inoperable."
"I understand. When you said battery, I thought of guns for some reason. Sergeant, get back in your litter. Magda, get my pack."
The young woman hurried off and was back in an instant.
"Here, mother."
"Thank you.
Now go fetch yours and make sure your water bottles are filled."
Magda hurried off again. Boadicea stared up at Yamato.
"You and Magda must go get help."
"What? Why us? I mean, I thought you fixed him."
"He will not die, but it will take twice as long for him to heal out here as it would in the village. And sooner or later, someone will come looking for that machine and its crew."
"Good point," the lieutenant said. In his comfortable litter, Rudy tried not to smile. Boadicea could run a recruit training center better than any 3 sergeants he knew. "But why Magda and me?
Pelagian is wounded. I must care for him. And the sergeant cannot travel as far and as fast as you need to go.
Why can't I just go and leave Magda here?
You would be lost within 3 hours without a guide, wouldn't you?
Yamato stared up at the sky and scuffed one foot. Finally, he whispered,
"Yeah, probably."
Magda returned with a pack on her back and looked down at her mother.
Who is going with me?
Take Consort and Errol, and... Bodisha pointed at Jerry, and Magda grinned. Rudy's laugh broke free.
What's so damn funny? Yamato demanded. You lose its cards, yes?
Rudy asked.
Yeah, mostly. What's your point?
You possess honest face, Lieutenant. What happens in your mind ends up there. Please to be careful. We need both of you.
I'll do what I can. Magda bent and kissed her father's cheek, then touched her mother's hair.
Za Alexander Highway is not far. 5 days at most, and we'll be back.
Find Frank, be careful, and hurry.
Come on, Lieutenant.
Magda whistled for the dogs and left the clearing without looking back. 6. Russia-Canada Highway, east of Tetlin Redoubt. General Spotted Bird surveyed the burning perimeter of Tetlin Redoubt through his field glasses. No movement. No resistance for over 2 hours.
Okay,
he said with a growl into his microphone.
Send in the Braves.
Infantry rose in both directions on the wide front, established earlier through cannon and other heavy weapons fire, and moved forward with caution and practiced alertness. The occasional crack of a rifle would bring the troopers down onto their bellies, but they didn't hesitate in their advance. No rounds came their way. The enemy offered a total lack of resistance.
What do you think fires twice?
General Spotted Bird asked, squinting over at his adjutant. The tall Sioux glanced at his commanding officer and nodded toward Tetlin.
I'd send in dog soldiers if it were up to me.
Why?
They handle the unexpected somewhat better than our less experienced troops, and they don't walk into a trap.
Agreed. Make it happen.
Colonel Fires Twice motioned to the radio man.
Contact Major Guthridge and tell him to execute planned prairie fire at once.
Yes, sir. The sergeant flipped switches on the large radio attached to the wide tank hull and spoke rapid Navajo into the microphone. Colonel Fires Twice cleared his throat and glanced at the general again.
You got something to say, say it,
the general said, peering through his field glasses.
We've run out of civilian liaison units. There were more towns in British Canada than we thought.
Don't worry about it, Franklin.
General Spotted Bird lowered the field glasses and bent his mouth as close to a smile as he could.
We're in Russian America now, and every place we take will be given to our northern brothers in arms.
Why are we doing that? We've already taken most of British Canada. If we're not out for conquest, why the hell are we still risking FPN lives?
General Spotted Bird peered through his binoculars again.
For the big picture, Franklin. For the future.
I'll take your word for it, General.
Sirs?
Sergeant Yahtzee, their radio talker, broke in.
Sergeant?
General Spotted Bird gave him his full attention.
Captain Guthrie says there is a man named Cassidy who just drove in and demands to see you. Says he was sent for.
General Spotted Bird grinned for the first time that day.
Indeed he was sent for. I sent for him. Have Mr. Cassidy brought forward at once.
Sergeant Yahtzee spoke into the microphone for a moment and then lapsed into silence. Colonel Fires Twice gave the general a look.
Is that Yukon Cassidy you sent for?
The general glassed the field again.
Yeah. Know him?
We were friends when we were boys. I haven't seen him since he got pissed and joined the Royal Canadian Rangers back in 73.
General Spotted Bird dropped his binoculars to his chest and gave the colonel a level stare.
You never told me you knew him?
You never asked, sir.
Why was a white kid living in the FBN?
His dad was one of those back-to-the-land rustics in the late 50s. His mother is Hunk Papa Sioux, so he's half Indian.
How long did the father last?
He's the chief administrator for the big hospital in Sioux Falls, still married to his wife after all these years.
That's amazing. Most of those guys went home after 3 months. What was Cassidy like as a kid?
Colonel Fires twice grinned and shook his head.
He got me into more damn trouble than any 5 other people put together. Always had a scheme that would make us some money, get us horses, or much later, find wild women.
And you haven't seen him for over 15 years?
The few times he came back to Pasapa to visit, I was out patrolling one of our borders. You know his record pretty well, General. How is that?
He's worked for me off and on for the last 10 years. Best facilitator I've ever seen.
I can easily believe that. He was always good in tight situations. One time, he and I...
A battered utility with a lodge top screeched to a stop beside the roulet tank, and both men watched a solidly built man of medium height climb out and look up at them.
General Spotted Bird, you sent for me?
His gaze wandered over to the other man in the wide tank hatch.
Frank? Is that really you?
With your permission, General?
Fires twice said with a wide grin.
By all means, Colonel. Go greet your friend.
Colonel Franklin Fires twice vaulted out of the hatch, landed on the hull, and then jumped to the ground. He and Cassidy grabbed each other in a fierce bear hug and danced in a circle, pounding each other on the back. When they pulled apart, General Spotted Bird saw tears on the faces of both men.
I've thought about you every damn day, Franklin said. Always wondering what you were up to, where you were, who you were.
You're looking good, Frank.
He wiped his eyes with a grimy sleeve.
And a full colonel, too. I always knew you'd get somewhere if I just got the hell out of the way. I've kept up on you, too. 2 valor shields in 1 career is a record, isn't it?
So they tell me. It is so good to see you, my brother.
We can't let this many years separate us again, agreed?
Agreed.
Now I have to report to the general.
Cassidy turned and looked up at Spotted Bird.
Any word on our outlaw? The Free Corps went through here over a week ago. They jumped the border in the middle of the night without killing anyone. The Russians had other fish to fry and put the incident on the back burner. Where they went from here is anyone's guess. Was Reardon with them? Oh, yes. Our witness was very sure of that point. Reardon's scout car nearly ran down the guy's kids. Reardon had the driver stop, and he screamed at the kids for being in his way. That asshole never changes, does he? There's a firefight ahead of us. We're taking out Tetlin Redoubt, but we can get you around the fighting and headed northwest if you wish. I would be most grateful, General Spotted Bird.
You're after Reardon?
Franklin Fires twice asked.
I'll bring him back to the First People's Nation to answer for his crime, my friend.
Isn't he surrounded by mercenaries?
So I've heard.
But how?
I'll see you when I get back, Frank. Please stay safe.
You too, Wayne.
Cassidy crawled back into the battered utility and started the engine. Then, with a wave, he swayed off down the road, stretching north into the heart of Russian America. 7. 57 miles south of Delta.
Major, we have sighting of Russian military,
Captain Rene Flair exclaimed through the window of the command car, jerking Timothy Reardon out of a deep sleep. After waiting 10 beats for his heart to slow, Reardon squinted his eyes and stared at his executive officer.
Are they actually attacking us, Rene?
No,
perish the very thought. They know nothing of our presence.
Then you should have carefully touched my shoulder and spoken softer tones, he said softly.
Then he screamed,
I nearly crapped myself when you startled me. 10 days of busting ass on the road takes it out of a man.
My apologies, Major Wilden, Flair said as he cringed. I was merely attempting to notify you in the most expeditious manner at my command.
Reardon sat up and glanced around.
Don't worry about it. This time. So, what's the situation?
Corporal Ingo and Private Kyle report they have made visual contact of a small group of Russian army vehicles and soldiers. They are at the junction where the road turns north again.
Small. How small?
2 tanks, 6 armored personnel carriers, and 3 trucks. No more than 40 Russians.
Good work, René.
Reardon jumped to his feet and adjusted his uniform. Squaring his beret, he flashed René a quick smile.
We're going to come out of this better than we are going in.
René smiled. 8. 58 miles south of Delta. Jerry fought his mixed emotions. He was in a combat situation among people he didn't know and had no idea of their viewpoint on anything other than killing Russians. He felt an increasing attraction to Magda. Sure, he had always appreciated a good-looking woman and would vie with his buddies for their favors. Even the engagement to Andrea had been more lark than not, and the sex had been awesome at first. Somehow, this was different. But was that due to the fact that she knew more about the current situation than he did, and he needed to prove dominance or something? This sudden change in the situation didn't give him pause, but it certainly put a new twist on things. She was a very strong-willed person. Physically brave, obviously intelligent, and would probably kill him if she thought it necessary.
This is the kind of girl my mother would like, Jerry muttered,
remembering how much his traditional mother had disliked Andrea. Ahead of him, Magda stopped and peered back over her shoulder.
Shut up,
she hissed.
This is Russian territory.
Jerry gave her a crisp salute and forgot Andrea. Watching Magda's body move under the moose hide was much more interesting. All of his gear had been returned, and he kept a weather eye on the compass embedded in the hilt of his survival knife. Even though she weaved around rock fields and brush too dense to penetrate, Magda maintained a bearing of north by northwest. Without the compass, Jerry knew he would have been lost within a half hour, even if he knew where he was going. Bodisha had been generous with her 3-hour guess. The 2 dogs fanned out on either side of the trail, never barking nor chasing the small animals spooked by their proximity. They crossed a crude road indented with the passing of tracked vehicles.
Tanks or armored personnel carriers, Jerry decided. Or both.
After moving out of sight of the road, he reached out and touched her arm. She wheeled, and the muzzle of her machine pistol pointed at his stomach.
What?
Aim that somewhere else, if you don't mind. I'm on your side, remember?
The muzzle dropped to her side.
Why did you stop me?
How long has it been since it rained here?
You want to talk about the weather?
I want to know how old those tracks are back there. They were well-defined, but dry. They could be a day or a month old, but they haven't been rained on. She had the courtesy to blush.
I'm sorry. I keep underestimating you, don't I?
He shrugged. You don't know me from Adam, as my mother likes to say. All you know is that I can fly a plane.
Thank you.
She awarded him a quick, dazzling smile.
It rained here 4 days ago. We had a downpour. Is there any way to determine their direction?
Not that I can tell, but tracking wasn't my easiest merit badge.
Let's go back and take a quick look, she said. Maybe I can see something you didn't.
With a gesture, he offered her the lead. She declined. He carefully retraced their path. The ground had been churned many times in the past. The willows were broken off or worn away for a full 10 meters. The vehicle hadn't been alone. Jerry could count 3 different sets and thought there might have been 4. After pointing this out to Magda, he hesitated and then said, "So, what else do you see?"
"Nothing. But perhaps there are things we should look for and ponder their significance."
"You have an extensive vocabulary for a girl who was raised in the middle of Russian America."
"We call it Alaska. Both of my parents are well-read and like to discuss what they read. One can learn much just listening, let alone reading. We should look for things they dropped or dragged."
"Equipment?"
"I was thinking more in the order of oil drops."
"Oil drops? How can that tell us their direction?"
"If they were moving at speed, the drops will point in the direction they were going."
"Okay. Let's look for oil drops."
"Won't take long," she murmured,
walking past him while searching the ground along the road.
"They don't take care of their equipment."
"That could get them in a lot of trouble out here in the middle of..."
"There!"
she said, somewhat more excited than he thought she would be. They weren't oil drops. Someone riding in the vehicle had emptied dark liquid, quite a lot of it. The largest splash mark lay southernmost. The constantly diminishing smaller marks pointed north. "Damn," Jerry muttered. "They're going the same direction we are."
"Yes, they are."
He looked up at her. "Thank you for teaching me that."
"You're welcome. Let's go. We're almost to the Tsar Nicholas Highway."
He followed Magda and her dogs into the brush. For an hour, he silently followed, trying to keep his mind on the situation and destination rather than where her presence led him.
"Let's stop for a while," Magda said.
She sat on a large rock, which now seemed rare.
"Would you like some squaw candy?"
"The kind your father gave me?" While opening her pack, she gave him a smirk.
"And what other kind would there be?"
He barked an embarrassed laugh, feeling more vulnerable than he would ever admit. "I meant the smoked fish. Don't be silly." Her face went solemn, and she handed him a strand of salmon.
"Why would you call me silly? That's something one says to a child."
"My God, Magda, you are most definitely not a child." Her face softened, and he felt his body relax. This didn't seem to be the place to explain how attractive he found her, but it did.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.